Dad! 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 Dad!
Oh.
It's important.
Then wait. Count to 20.
No, Dad, you listen.
Junior!
1, 2, 3, 4.
In Greek.
Ena, Theo, Thea. Tessida, Dente.
May he who illuminated this illuminate me.
Hey guys, FutureRail Products here. We've been given permission and access to the Indiana Jones house from Last Crusade. Let's go inside.
Hi, welcome to Indiana Jones Bed and Breakfast.
Hey everyone, FutureRail Productions here. I am here at the Indiana Jones Bed and Breakfast, the actual house that was used in The Last Crusade. I'm with...
My name is Sabra. I'm the owner and innkeeper.
Yes, so she bought the house when?
I started as an innkeeper in November of 2016, and then I bought it in April of 2017.
Okay, and the house was built in the 1880s?
In 1888.
Okay, so... We're sitting in what was essentially Henry Jones Sr.'s office. So
yes.
The desk was here, and then for Indy, well, you can't see it on camera, but right behind the camera is the doorway that young Indy would actually come storming through and be like, Dad, Dad. And then Senior was like, Junior!
Junior!
Yeah. So what kind of inspired you to buy the house?
Well, I actually had moved out here after living in Northern California and raising my kids for 25 years, and I had come to visit my cousins. I've been coming out here since I was a little kid, and I had come to visit. I went on a 6,000-mile road trip by myself one summer, and I had stopped in Denver, see my cousins there, and then my last stop in Colorado was in Grand Junction, and I have a cousin that lives there as well. And as I was leaving, I was like, it's time. Like, I was been wanting to move for a while, and it just, you know, and then after this road trip, which was about a month long, I just decided it was time to leave. So I went back to California, and about a month later, I told all my friends, hey, I'm packing up all my stuff and I'm moving to Colorado. And they were like, what? Like, you're going to Colorado? It's cold there. And you know. And I was like, well, I've lived in cold places before. It's not a big deal. And so I did. I packed. So I spent the rest of the year in California. And so I started going through all my stuff, packing everything up. And I started looking for a job. And I found a job as an executive chef at a private elk hunting lodge in New Mexico.
All right.
And which is only about 24 miles from Antonito South. Right over the state line. And
right.
So I interviewed on the phone with them twice. They hired me, so I had a job when I came down here. And so I went to work for them. And I had to come into Alamosa to do grocery shopping for all of the hunters and stuff that would come. And I got here in September of 2016. And I just started really falling in love with the area. It was quiet. There wasn't a lot of traffic. You know, it was a livable place. You know, and I was like, well, we'll see what the winter's like, you know. And because I've lived in Wisconsin, Eastern Oregon, Eastern Washington. I was in the Coast Guard in Massachusetts as a small boat station. And we did a lot of heavy weather training in the North Atlantic. So the cold weather, I was not super concerned about it.
Right.
So I had a week off between hunting groups. And I had come down into Antonito for my time off. And I stayed at another hotel in town. And I was talking to somebody that worked there. And I had asked him, I'm looking for a winter job. You know, is there like a lodge that needs a caretaker? You
right.
know, I'll shovel out stalls. It doesn't matter. I just need a place to be for the winter. And he says, oh, I don't know. Let me check around. So he found me. I was walking my dogs in our huge town here. And he found me. I guess he drove for like over four or five blocks trying to find me the next morning. And he found me. And he said, oh, the Indy house needs an innkeeper for the winter. And I didn't know what the Indy house was. I still had been here for 2.5 months and still had no idea this house was here.
Yeah.
And I kept seeing the train. I was like, ooh, that's super cool. And I was like, ooh, I need to check that out.
Yeah.
So
what was your reaction when he said that, oh, it's the Indiana Jones house?
Well, he kept trying to explain it to me. And I was thinking of the second house in the movie that was Indy Senior's house.
Right.
Henry Jones Senior house.
Right, the one that got ransacked.
Yeah, that got ransacked. And I was like, that's not in Colorado. Like, I was very confused. And he said, no, at the beginning, the train, he hopped, you know, blah, blah, blah. And I was like, it still wasn't clicking for me. But the next morning, I came over to interview with the previous owner. And I came around the corner, and when I saw the house, I knew exactly which house he was talking about.
Yeah.
Like, I was super excited, and I think I made a noise only my dogs could hear, because I was like, oh my God, this is so exciting. And I came in, and we geeked out for a couple hours.
Yeah.
He hired me to be the innkeeper, and then at that time, he also said that the house was on the market. And if I was interested in buying it, to let him know. And I was like, well, I don't know if I want to be here, you know, if I want to stay here, where I'm going to go next.
Right.
And we made it through a very cold winter here. And I was like, I need a house. I need to earn some income,
mm-hmm.
you know. So it was perfect. I
yeah.
could live in the house, earn the income, have the super cool, like, piece of movie history. And because this movie actually came out the year my daughter was born.
Really?
And I lived in Marin County for 20-ish years. And that's where my kids, that's where Skywalker Ranch is. And I used to, when my kids were younger, I worked in retail. And I would help George Lucas a lot in the stores.
Wow.
So I have a kind of a connection to all of this in roundabout ways. And so in February of 2017, I was like, told the previous owner, I said, okay, I think I want to buy the house. So,
and I
did.
Yeah. So, you've been restoring it and trying to make it look as close as movie conditions
yeah.
possible.
Mm-hmm.
And so, I noticed you have the sign out front, which, you know, was on the mailbox.
Yes.
And that got damaged in the storm.
Yes.
You know.
So we've had some really severe winds this spring. I mean, it's always really windy down here in the spring. But this has just been sustained, like, awful wind. And one morning I went to go to my other job. And I looked, and the mailbox looked a little weird.
Right.
And I got out of my Jeep, and I walked over there. And I was like, oh, the lid's missing. And I was like, ugh. So, and I looked around the yard to see it. I was hoping nobody stole it because,
right.
you know, people do that, those things. And I happened to look down, and it was laying right behind the mailbox. But the part where the hinges go on it
mm-hmm.
had cracked off. So I couldn't replace it onto
right.
the mailbox. Plus, the lid itself is cracked.
Yeah.
And it's reinforced with a couple of braces. So I decided, you know what? I'm just going to put it in the window so people can still see it.
Right.
And I'll just build a new lid for the mailbox and put it on. And it's about half done right now.
Right.
So.
Do you have it? Can, like, we see it or something?
The original lid?
The new one.
The new one. It's just a piece of wood right now.
Okay.
I'm soaking it in oil.
Oh, okay.
To make it easier to sand it down. I have to cut a angle on the front of it.
Right.
Everything is just so dry here. I just have it in... soaking in oil right now. It's
yeah.
just a little easier to work with. And then once that's done, I'll go out and touch up the post. And
right.
And
that's the original post.
Yes.
The original post.
It's the actual mailbox from the movie.
Yeah. All right. So this is probably going to be a hot take, but what's your thoughts on Indiana Jones 4?
It's kind of funny because we talk about when people bring it up, I'm like, we don't talk about that movie in this house. And although it is part of the series, you know, I mean, it is an Indiana Jones movie. And
yeah, because I saw a poster up on the top of the stairs.
Yeah, and I have a couple of the Crystal Skulls, too, in the house.
Right.
You know, it's an indie movie. Of course, I will always watch it. But as far as keeping in theme and how good the other three movies were, I was really disappointed in the storyline. Although, I have to tell you, listening to my parents and my grandparents talk about nuclear drills when they were in school, and then you know, hiding in certain places if a bomb came, and then that whole scene where he hops into the refrigerator in the nuclear town, and oh my god, that has got to be probably one of the best, funniest scenes in any Indiana Jones movie. Like, I love that scene in the movie. It's so ridiculous, but it's so funny.
And it theoretically could work if you didn't get launched into the stratosphere.
Correct. Because those refrigerators at that time were lead lined.
Yeah.
And I'm actually, one of the things that kind of bothers me about that, one thing is those refrigerators did not open from the inside. A lot of kids died in old refrigerators because of that.
Yeah.
And now there's a safety feature in all new refrigerators where they have to, I think it changed in like the early 70s. And so now, you know, if you get trapped in a fridge, you can open the door from the inside. But I don't know how he was able to open the door from the inside.
I think maybe the lock busted.
Maybe, yeah.
On the
but that was my only, like,
nitpick of it. Yeah.
Yeah, so.
Yeah, but I feel like, though, even though he got out of the refrigerator, he'd still get the radiation.
He'd still have the radiation and everything, for sure.
Yeah, because that was pretty close. I mean, if he just continued walking away, maybe. Right. But he just walked up over that hill and be like... Yeah. Are you excited for the fifth film coming out?
I am very excited for the fifth film to come out.
Yeah, I'm just kind of upset that it's kind of supposed to be the last one.
Well, so for me, growing up with Star Wars and Indiana Jones, I mean, Star Wars came out when I was almost 11.
Right.
So I went to opening day for that. And just kind of growing up with all these films and stuff, and like, there's been talk about, you know, recasting adult Indy, and people are like, well, he's already been played by all these other actors. I was like, no. Young Indy was played by River Phoenix, and who are the other two actors from the TV show? I can't remember their names off the top of my head.
Right.
So, and then, you know, also on the TV show, they had the really old Indiana Jones that was played by another actor. But Indiana Jones himself as an adult, like, I don't think there's anybody that could replace Harrison Ford in that role.
Yeah.
Like, maybe if he was younger or older, but not in his current timeline of the last four movies.
Right.
And including the fifth, I guess.
Well, I mean, I would like to see, like, late teens, early 20s Indy when he was riding with Pancho Villa.
Right. So, I'm really excited for the fifth movie to come out, but I think if they were going to... I don't think they can recast...
Indy
himself, but young Indy, ancient Indy, maybe.
Yeah.
But I think for the time period of one through five,
right.
I don't think there's no actor, even Chris Pratt, that could replace Harrison Ford.
I would like to see, like, there are points in Indy's life that are between the movies.
Yes.
I would like to see those kind of things.
I would too, and I think having a different actor play those would be okay, but like, just for the indie movies, like, Harrison Ford is Indiana Jones, period.
I mean, and they could always de-age him too.
Right. Yeah.
I mean, that technology has gotten a lot better.
They did that in film 5.
Yeah.
Because I've seen photos of, like, the actual, like, you know, still from a scene, and then of just, like, him without, you know, any de-aging. And then you can see the clip from the film itself where they have de-aged him.
Yeah.
So I know they're already doing that, but for the most part, like, he's an old man in the fifth movie.
Yeah.
You know, he's not a young spring chicken anymore.
Yeah. I mean, that was the same thing. That was the same thing for 4. And from what I was kind of hoping, yes, 4 left a little bitter taste in my mouth, but with 4, the hat rolling towards, you know, Mutt, I mean, that really could have, you know, set up a next generation if it wasn't so bad.
Right. And a lot of people were really disappointed with, Mutt's character and all that. And then my daughter-in-law actually said, well, Mutt you know, that poor guy. And then we started talking about it, and the more I thought about it, I was like, well, yeah, his dad abandoned him, you know, yeah. His mom was always off on adventures, and well, they may have loved him, they weren't like the best parents in the world.
Yeah, and then he technically already had a dad that right. looked up to him.
But then they lied about who his real dad was.
Yeah.
So I feel like Mutt has a little bit of trauma
yeah.
that is totally not dealt with. So for me, you know, after my daughter-in-law that I talked about, I was like, yeah, you know what, that actually kind of makes sense. So. Yeah.
So do you think Marion, like, I know they've already listed all the casting for, you know, the fifth film, but do you think Marion will come back at, like kind of like, you know how you have...
I hope she does.
Yeah, I'm hoping, like, there's, like, they've kept it so tightly under wraps that, like, she just shows up for, like, 5 seconds. Like,
right.
Like, because, like, when you look at the, a good example is Ghostbusters Afterlife.
Mm-hmm.
We just thought, oh, we're getting a new cast. They're just going to mention, you know, the original Ghostbusters. And then they show up at yeah, the end
exactly.
of the movie.
Exactly, yeah. I love that kind of stuff. And I love it especially when the spoilers don't come out.
Right.
You know, I went for almost 2 years after Star Wars Rogue One came out, without any spoilers. Like, I don't even know how I managed to avoid all those spoilers. But yeah. when I watched it... I was like, oh my God, this is the best Star Wars movie ever.
Yeah. And I mean, some people would disagree with you on that. I mean,
Rogue One was amazing.
I liked Rogue One, but to me, it felt like a movie that didn't have to be made.
Oh, see, I thought it did because I kind of like the fill-in.
Right. The tie-in to yeah, you know, episode 4.
To yeah. episode 4, which I, you know.
You know, it's but they did make a pretty good explanation in the original film. Yeah. Oh, these plans were beamed to the ship, you know.
Right. But I really enjoyed Rogue One a lot, and the scene with Darth Vader walking down the hallway and just
I
was like, oh my God, this is amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's my favorite Darth Vader besides Empire Strikes Back yeah. Vader. Yeah. So.
Have you had a chance to watch Obi-Wan Kenobi yet?
Yes, I've watched all 3 of the new episodes. Amazing. I'm so excited.
I love the, like, this is probably going to go up after all 6 episodes come out, but like, I love how Vader is just like, I'm going to make you suffer, and literally drags
yes.
him through fire, like,
yes.
like just to give him a taste of the pain that he got when he was yeah. burning from lava.
Right.
I mean, fire, I mean, technically...
Lava sticks.
Yeah. Yeah, but fire, you know, fire just tickles and burns your skin.
Right.
But that's the thing. Like, lava fire, if I recall correctly, burns a lot hotter than just standard oil
right,
fires.
Right,
so,
does.
Technically, you can't compare the two unless you chop off all 4 limbs and dump Obi-Wan in lava.
Right. And I love that they have little Leia in there.
Yeah, that's just,
she's
so cute.
She's so adorable.
And she's so sassy.
She is sassy.
Like, just like Padme. She is sassy.
Exactly. And then you can kind of see, like, you know, like, If she's like this as a young child, now you know why she's so sassy as an adult.
Yeah,
know?
Exactly. And it's just amazing. Like, the casting, like, you get that kind of, like, vibe from her that, you know, kind of like in Last Jedi, you kind of get that
yeah.
tiny little Force sensitivity
yep,
vibe.
Exactly.
You know?
And I love that they brought back, you know, Bail and
yeah.
his wife, who were the two original actors that they
yep.
had in...
The actor and actress.
The
Rogue
third,
One
yep.
and 3.
Yep.
Were they in 2?
Nah, Bale was.
Bale was in 2,
yeah. And so, like, anyway, I'm a big old nerd, so I can talk about this all day.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, the first indie movie came out when I was 15, and I didn't necessarily want to be in... I met tons of people who became archaeologists or anthropologists because of Indiana Jones movies.
Right.
But I wasn't necessarily interested in that part of it, because I spent a lot of time when I was a kid... in Colorado and other places doing, like, dinosaur hikes and Indian mound stuff with my
right.
aunts. And so for me, I was like, man, okay, you know. It's interesting, but it's not something I want to do for a living. I wanted the adventure he had. Like,
yeah.
I wanted to travel. I wanted to go all these really cool places. You know, so I traveled a lot before my kids were born. I've traveled a lot, you know, when they were adults. And we did a lot of road trips and stuff when they were kids. But... traveling outside of the country, I did most of that before they were born. So,
okay.
But yeah, that's really what turned me on to Indiana Jones was the adventure part of it. And let's just face it, he's a grave robber.
Yeah, let's face it.
Let's just face it.
Nowhere that does show more than when he's just like, he picks up, what's the character that got the crystal skull away from the city in the fourth film?
It was the
conquistador guy.
Oh god, I can't think of his name. I can't remember, but I know what you're talking about.
But he just picks up his body like this, and is like, hold this, and just shoves it into his son's.
Like, and he destroys everything. Like, he go like the temples when he stole the fertility idol.
Yeah.
You know, all those things. Like, really, he is just, he says it belongs in a museum.
Yeah.
My opinion, art like that
but
belongs
the
to the people who created it.
Right. But the interesting thing about that whole theme is, he hears about an artifact, you have the bad guys going after the artifact, but then he never gets the artifact.
Right.
But then he learns from the adventure of finding the artifact.
Yeah. Which I think is pretty cool too. But my guess and I actually talk about that a lot.
Yeah.
About, you know, being a grave robber. It's just...
Yeah, and you know, even though the fourth film's themes are all over the place, if you put them all in, like, you know, order, like,
right.
I know there's, like, a video I found on YouTube. If I can remember it, I'll probably, like, cut it in over top of the audio here. But I remember that he put every single movie, he took it all, every single piece of footage, took it all apart, put it in chronological order, so starting with Last Crusade, then jumping right into Raiders, then, you jumped into Temple of Doom, then Raiders, and then Crystal Skull.
Right.
And you, it's Raiders, Last Crusade, then
Crystal Skull.
And then he basically showed how Indy's character developed over time.
Because
you have, in the first movie, he says, oh, it belongs into a museum, then he gets the, you know, course cross Colorado, then he gets taken away. But then he knows, like, he sees the guy with the fedora hat as the bad guy.
Right.
And then when he gets to Temple of Doom, he's just like every other bad guy in the movies. And then defeating Kalaram, whatever his name is. And he kind of learns...
Kalima,
yeah. And he learns from his mistake. And then, you know, instead of keeping the Sakura stone?
Yes.
I think that's how you say it, right? Sakura stone?
Mm-hmm.
And then he, you know, instead of keeping it and putting it in the museum, he gives it
back.
Right.
Yeah.
And that leads him into becoming, you know, going into Raiders. And he's not so, like, he still has that kind of bad guy feel because he wants to get the Ark of the Covenant for the museum.
Right.
But then he realizes, okay, this is too powerful for any
for
man.
Any human being to have.
Yeah. And so he just closes his eyes and Marion looks away.
Yeah.
And, and then by the time he gets Last Crusade, he finally gets the Cross of Coronado back, which he wanted to put in the museum in the first place, and managed it to put in the museum.
Yeah.
And I think out of every single artifact that he's ever come across, that's the only one he put in the museum, right?
Yeah. it's just really interesting, like, the kind of, like, talking about, like, well, would they, you know, and this is, like, film critic stuff, you know?
Yeah.
Like, would they make these films today? Would they pass, you know, the test because there's a lot, but you know, there's also like, he was born in 1899, you know, and
the end of the Wild West era,
exactly,
and the new, you know, the 20th century.
So there was a lot of, era sensitive things that happened back then. And yes, they're correctly represented in the movie, but then, you know, it's,
In today's
viewpoint, it's more like...
Like, yeah, does that...
kind of cringy a little bit, some of the stuff, you know, but...
Yeah, like the Temple of Doom stuff with, what's her name? The blonde.
Shit.
we really need to, like, have, like,
we're
a
so
book.
Bad!
But whoever's love interest was in that movie,
yeah.
And then kind of the treatment of Short Round, you know.
Yeah, that, and the actor who played him actually left the film industry, so he did Last Crusade, and then he did Goonies, and in Goonies, he was still cast as that very stereotypical, you know, Asian character.
Yeah.
And he actually left the film industry after Goonies because they only wanted to give him those kinds of stereotypical roles.
That's stupid.
And it was really dumb. And I've just been reading a lot of articles about him lately where he's wants to come back.
Really?
But he also discusses, you know, how kind of painful it was for him to be cast type.
Yeah.
You know, and again, that was the 80s. The 80s and the 90s were like that. So,
right.
And I'm glad, you know, that they're kind of not doing that so much anymore.
Yeah, I'm kind of glad of that too.
But I'm glad that he's interested in coming back into the film industry because I thought he was, you know, regardless of the his very stereotypical role, like imagine being a kid that young and remembering all those lines, doing the action filming, you know, all those things. That's pretty amazing. You know, so.
All right. So, favorite Indiana Jones trap, like from like any booby trap.
Honestly, I really liked in Temple of Doom with the Temple of Doom. Where they get stuck behind the door, the rotating door, and there's all the bugs and stuff in there.
Right.
And they both get caught in there, and they have to find their way out. And then the other one I like is from Raiders, is actually where he's... that was also Temple of Doom, where he's chased by the boulder. And
right.
So those... Actually, I think... Well, then I guess both of them, the traps are from Raiders.
Yeah.
Temple of Doom, sorry. Right.
And then there's the boulder and Raiders.
Right? Yeah.
I think for me, my favorite trap is the is in Last Crusade. It's the it's the second trap.
In the castle where they're tied to the chairs.
No. In the temple where the Grail is.
Oh, right.
Where you know spelling the Lord's name Jehovah.
Oh, right.
Then instead of going J, and then it's like
it's the H instead.
Yeah.
And oh well, one of my favorite scenes from that movie from Last Crusade actually is where he's in his at the beginning he's like in his classroom. And what university just lets their professors just take off like that all the time? Like, he would have lost his job.
Yeah.
As a side. But I do like the fact where he's in class and he's like, X never, ever, ever marks the spot. And then when they get into the library,
X marks the spot.
There, and that's where they have to go in. I laughed so hard when I saw that.
Yeah,
so,
and he's just like, X marks the spot.
X marks the spot. So, yeah.
So, what do you see for this house? Like, what do you see the future of? I mean, obviously, you want to get it to look as close as movie, you know, accurate as possible, but do you foresee yourself ever, you know, keeping the house? Do you foresee, you know, eventually making it, like, a National Historic Landmark or something like that?
So, in the process of working on getting in, to start a Colorado monument, or, historical location, but that application is like 100 pages long, so that's a long process. I have a friend of mine that's gonna help me like write the grant process for all that and everything, because I don't have the patience to write a grant. Like I know I have all the ideas in my head, but I can't put them on paper.
Right.
So I want to start with the Colorado historical designation, which is separate from a different kind of historical designation where you can't change anything about the house, because obviously I have to replace my windows.
Right.
You know, there's certain designations where you can't change anything on the outside, and I don't want to be restricted by that.
Right.
So the new windows that are going in will be painted, the frames will be green, it'll look almost exactly what's there now, but just more energy efficient and everything else.
Right.
So that's one thing that we're working on. Plus, it allows me to gain access to more construction funds that I don't have to, you know, replace the windows, do the stucco. I need to replace the front porch overhang. It's falling down. I mean, it's an old house. It takes a lot of money to run it.
Right.
So we really only do one big project a year in the house.
Okay.
This year was taking all the gross carpet from upstairs and replacing it with a a waterproof laminate flooring that looks exactly like this wood right here.
Really?
So that was our big project for this year. Last year, it was painting the whole downstairs, doing the flooring, and then of course my furnace went out in the middle of trying to do the floor, so the furnace, it was in December when the furnace went out, so I didn't have heat in the house for a whole month. It was just tore up in here. I had a hole in my floor.
Yeah.
While they were replacing ductwork and everything, so that expense stopped me from finishing the floor, you know, but it was more important to replace the gross carpet upstairs than it was to do this right now. I'm going to have rugs on it. I tell everybody that walks in, I have half a floor. You know, it's stable, it's sturdy, it's safe, but this is why. All these planks that we took out, we have to hand sand them because they're so thin that I'm afraid to use a mechanical sander on them.
Right.
And the floor was polyurethaned, which is the absolute wrong thing to do in this environment. We're in a desert environment here. Mm-hmm. The polyurethane doesn't allow for expansion and contraction of the wood.
Right.
So once we pull everything out, it'll be this winter we do that.
Mm-hmm.
We have to hand sand each of these down and then have them reinstalled. I do have to get some replacement pieces because, of course, they're so fragile. Some of them broke when we were pulling them up.
Right.
And then everything will get put down, and then we'll paste wax the whole floor,
mm-hmm.
buff it, and it'll be done.
Okay.
So, and then all these panels in here,
mm-hmm.
When they put them in, they didn't gap them properly, and all the chinking is falling out. So this wood in here will get pulled out and then moved over and put in, and then we'll just put like a quarter round in this corner right there.
Okay.
You know, to cover the gap. But like, this is like original wood to the house.
Yeah.
But it's not gapped properly. And again, because of the extreme temperature swings we have here, the extreme humidity swings we have here. And these are also polyurethane, so these all have to be sanded down,
mm-hmm.
get all that poly off, and then they'll also be hand waxed, and it'll help keep it from cracking and warping and all those other things. So. All
right. Holy crap, look at that. God. Hi, kitty. Hi. Yeah, you're probably wondering what this is, right? So this is the front parlor.
Yes. So in the movie, they actually had these spindles covered, and you can see that in this photograph up here, which is halfway through the remodel for the movie. They've covered up the spindles, and they had the piano there. I'm actually looking for a piano to put there.
Right.
But I haven't found the right one yet.
Okay.
And
do you know what model it is?
I don't know. I have to look at the... It's so brief in the film that it's hard to tell, but if I take this photo here to the a piano person, they can probably identify it for me.
To me, it looks like a Steinway almost.
Yeah, I
obviously it's not something you would find on the Titanic.
Right. And then there's this little, in the movie, when you see him right through the doors, you see this little embroidery piece. And for the longest time in the movie, I couldn't quite read what it said. So I got this photo,
mm-hmm.
and I just took a magnifying glass on it and looked at it. And I know it's a quote-unquote prayer, but it's actually like a little thing that an actual bread company from back then sent out as advertising.
Really?
So I'm, because I cross stitch and embroider, I'm gonna go ahead and make that at some point.
And then you're gonna put it right back there, yeah.
Yep.
So is there any plans to like get Henry Sr.'s original desk and like put it like, you know, the same style desk and put it in?
So that is a really close. It was a mission style desk that
this.
He had. And this is really close to it. So this I'm gonna refinish. And I have to, some of the books and stuff that were on there, like I can get replicas made of them.
Okay.
And I do have certain things, like I have ink wells already that I can put on the desk. I have feathers that look like the pen he was using. I'm gonna put those on the desk. I pretty much have to use art, what is it? Art clay to hold everything down to the table because the cat.
Blue tack?
Yeah. Otherwise, the cats will knock everything off. So, yeah, my intent is to recreate the desk, put the bookshelves back up.
Right.
I'm still looking for the piano. I do have to do a lot of work on the house. Like, I have to have the center line of the house reinforced. It's an old house. It was built in 1888. So, I don't want to put anything heavy on the floor in there yet.
Right.
Until I get this redone. We just had all the floor joists in this section replaced 2 winters ago.
Right.
And the furnace went out in the whole middle of that. So that's why half the floor is missing. I still have the boards.
Okay.
Because these are the original oak floor to the house.
So these were in the movie?
Yes.
Oh, that's so cool.
They've been refinished since then, but they're actually the house was built in 1888. I think the actual oak was put in probably around 1895 or so, 1900.
Right.
Because when, I don't know what happened to it, but when we were pulling up the planks, there's actually some really ancient linoleum type flooring that they left this one little small piece and just put the wood right over the top of it. So I pulled that out and I saved it. That's going in a collage of original hand-painted ceiling paper I took out of the ceiling when I had to repair it.
So this, you can see in the movie.
It was all white in the movie. They painted all this white in the movie, but I had to replace this whole panel here.
Uh-huh.
Because I had some water damage, and that's why there's a trap door there now.
Right.
So when I pulled the old ceiling down, it had the hand-painted paper from when the house was originally built.
Wow.
So three layers of it.
Because
they didn't clean any of it. They didn't take it down. And so what they do is they have all the floor joists in there, and then they just cover it with muslin, which I still have a piece of that too. And then they just put paper over the top of it. When it gets dirty, they just put another piece of paper over the top of it. They don't take it down. They don't clean it. They just keep covering it up. And so I found three layers of that under there.
Wow.
So, and it's actually in really good condition. I was really surprised. So for as old as the house is.
Yeah.
The doors were, when I bought the place, the doors were painted white and green. These were white and green.
Right.
When we and this green went all the way up to the ceiling. And I was looking for something in the movie. It was a piece of furniture or something I was trying to figure out. Anyway, I was looking at it, and after we had painted down here,
mm-hmm.
I was like, oh, we had inadvertently painted this white without realizing it was also white in the movie, because, you know, there's so much detail in the movie. And so, and the reason I wanted the top white is for all these photos.
Right.
Like a gallery. And I was like, oh, well, it looks just like the movie now.
So in the movie, this is green.
Yep.
And then that's white on top.
Correct.
Okay, that's really cool.
Yeah, and this is white in the movie. The doors are brown.
Right.
So I'm trying to at least get it
As close as you can.
As close as I can, within reason. There's certain things I'm not going to be able to do, like completely recreate his office, because I have to have my dining room for my guests, things right. like that.
Didn't he have a stained glass window in the movie?
No. There was no stained glass. Not in this house, anyway. There's a drawing he was working on in his book.
Oh, that's the stained glass
that's
window.
That's the stained glass,
okay,
yeah.
Because I'm... For some reason, I might be remembering the scene differently, but I'm seeing like these all these colors that are coming in through the window. Like there's like blues, reds, and greens and stuff like that.
I don't remember that.
Yeah, I don't.
I'll have to look again, but
yeah, that's
he. So I have stained glass hanging in the window because I like stained glass.
Okay, so are these windows original or?
So these windows, I think, from around 1920.
Okay.
Because they're single pane, double hung. They have a rope in there. You know, and they're getting replaced at some point.
Okay, because if I remember, that's what I'm thinking. Because if his desk was here, because it was in this shot.
Yeah.
And you could see light pouring through this window, and there was like blues, reds, and hitting the table.
That I didn't notice. Like he might have had stained glass hanging in the window.
Yeah.
But the windows themselves were clear.
When the movie was filmed.
Yes.
Okay, so maybe that's what I remember. It was hanging stained glass.
It could be. Yeah. Yeah. I'll have to look again. Like there's a lot of details, and I'm old. And then in the movie, so they had the lace curtains, and then they had these like kind of velvety looking ones on the edge, and
right.
I actually have the exact fabric and color of those side things, and they had wooden rings on them, and I have those too. So I just have to make the curtains for each side of these windows.
Okay.
To match the movie.
All right, this is really cool.
And then that's the innkeeper room.
Right.
I was in there originally when I bought the place. Jasmine's my niece. She's down here helping me run the bed and breakfast. A lot of the stuff on the walls are from guests. Somebody gave me this. Somebody gave me this comic book. This was in the house when I bought it. A guest sent me this. I bought both of these off of Amazon.
Right. So what's the story with the hat and the bag and the whip? Are these original?
No, I don't have anything original in the house.
Okay, well, I mean, are they actually from the movies?
No. This is a replica.
All right.
That I went to go visit a friend of mine in North Carolina in March. And he's like, oh, how would you like an Indiana Jones hat? And I thought, oh, well, it's just, you know, like a whatever. And I flipped it over and looked at the inside. I was like, oh my God, you know how hard these are to find.
Yeah.
So he gave that to me. A guy who lives in town, his family knew the family that lived in this house years ago. He gave me this bag, and the whip was in the house when I bought it.
Okay.
So close. A lot of, you know, a few replica things, you know.
Right. But then some of them are original to the house.
Yeah. When I bought it.
When you bought it, right. And the jacket here, that's...
That was in the house when I bought it as well. And it is not an actual Indiana Jones jacket, but it is very close to one. And the one I want to buy is very expensive, so I'm saving up for it.
Right.
So once I order that and get it in, I'll replace it.
Right.
But I just kind of wanted it to look like, you know, he came home, he was, you know, tired, he just hung his stuff up and wanted to sit down and relax.
Yeah.
So that's why that's there.
I can understand that.
Yeah.
Especially we're riding with Pancho Villa, right?
Right?
Yeah.
So, what else? And then I told you about the mailbox, the lid blew off in one of our windstorms. And
that's it in the window.
Yeah, I still have the mailbox lid, and I'm making a new one to put on there.
Right.
I just haven't
gotten around to it.
Yeah, it's, you know, there's a lot of work to do on the house. I am going to have the windows replaced, hopefully next year. Windows are not cheap, especially
right.
at high altitude. And I'm getting all double hung windows because the windows are so low to the ground in the summer for circulation. I want to be able to open the tops of the windows. Opposed
right.
to the bottoms. So I'm hoping by next summer we have those in. Also have to have the house restuccoed. It is an adobe house.
Okay.
So with a stucco exterior, a lot of almost all of the lath and plaster that was from the original, when it was originally built, is still behind all the sheetrock upstairs. So a lot of the work that was done on the house was just to maintain it and not change it.
Okay.
So,
alright.
Yeah. So when I bought the property, these doors were green and white, and of course I knew from the movies that they were supposed to be brown. So we did finally get them painted last spring to be the brown, and I went through probably about, I don't know, 8 different browns to figure out which one would look good, and this is the best one. And I actually didn't know this about the house when I bought it. So the original house had these craftsman style windows on both sides of the double doors that were also glass. I had no idea that this glass was behind here.
Uh-huh.
And it's on both sides.
Okay.
And it actually has the measurements from the carpenter that came in to remodel the house, and it's still there.
Oh my God, that is so cool.
So I took the back panels off to see, mm-hmm. and I left them off so I can show people the glass and the measurements and everything. All
right.
So my plans for this area is to put the bookcases back in from the movie.
Okay.
But I have to finish my floor first, so I can't put the bookcase in.
Right.
So what I'm going to do is leave the back of the bookcase open,
mm-hmm.
so you can see the glass. I'm going to poly over the, this is pencil,
mm-hmm.
and I'm going to poly over that so it doesn't disappear.
Right.
But I'll leave this all open behind, you know, in the back of the bookcase so people can see the glass and everything, because I thought that was super cool. All right. And I lived in the house for about 2.5 years before I knew that.
Okay.
So.
All right. That's cool.
And then they had a wall on this little section here that was so all that you couldn't see in the movie.
Right.
And then that's where they had like his tub was hanging there. All of his crap was on the wall. This is where the little potbelly stove was.
All right.
And then in the scene when he runs into the house and he stands at the doors, it's on this side of the doors. The doors are closed.
Mm-hmm.
But when he runs in, the desk and the camera is actually facing this way.
Okay.
And so he's, you know, you could see him writing, and then you can see
Indy run in,
and he's like, count to 10 in Greek. Yeah. And then he's counting to 10, and then he leaves and he closes the doors. But the end of that whole kind of scene of the house, he's actually sitting in front of this window at that point.
Okay. So this is where Henry's desk would have been in that last sequence.
Correct. Yeah, in the last section of that scene, was movie trickery.
Oh.
So.
But they took the original desk with them.
Yeah, everything. When I bought this place, some of the photos were here. You know, some of the stuff that's in the house is here, but almost everything else isn't in here. I've bought, guests have sent me as gifts. My Instagram followers have sent me stuff. A lot of it was mine when I moved out here. So. All
right. Cool.
Yep. I am going to refinish this desk. And I do have quite a few things that actually match from the movie. Need to get a couple of his journals, a couple of the books,
right.
Things like that, and I am going to recreate the desk.
Yeah, so you're going to, so with the some of the things that you're recreating, are you going to actually have the page that he was working on open?
Yes, yeah.
Okay.
Because there are actually people who recreated, like prop makers,
mm-hmm.
who reproduce all those things. Honestly, I'm pretty artistic. I'm not that artistic.
Right.
So, and to be completely transparent about it, a lot of the stuff I'll buy from here or buy for his desk will be reproductions, and I will have to buy them.
Okay.
And have somebody make them.
So you said the camera was like approximately right here, right?
I think about right here.
Okay,
probably.
So let me see if I can get that shot. Yeah, because I feel like it was off to the side a little bit. And
slightly.
Yeah, so.
Yeah.
So the door's right there, and the camera obviously was zoomed in, right?
Yes.
So which side was Indy standing on the door?
He was actually, when he came in, he was standing right here.
Okay, so to me, I feel like the camera should be like farther over, like this, and zoomed in.
But when I don't see, it's hard to tell because when the camera's looking this way, it's literally looking at the center of the doors when their doors are closed.
Okay.
So maybe
like this almost.
That's entirely possible because then the desk would have been about right here.
Right.
At the beginning of that scene.
So if let me get lower here. So maybe like at about this angle, pointed up slightly.
Right. Because I mean, if you do notice in the movie, you don't see Henry Sr.'s face.
You just see his hand, and if he's sitting right here.
Because it was a body double.
Right.
Sean Connery was never actually here, but George Lucas was here, Harrison Ford was here, River Phoenix was here.
Right.
George Youngwing was here, who played the guy who gave Indiana Jones his hat.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of the actors in that scene were definitely here in town. Harrison Ford came and Steven Spielberg as well.
Right.
And I do have pictures, more photos, private photos that were given to me after I bought the property.
Right. And I don't think I could see those, right?
But I haven't, I think they're in that stack over there.
Okay.
That we're still working on. But on my Instagram page, I always, once we get new stuff up, we always photograph it. And we always put it on Instagram to share with my fans, with the guests.
Right.
Not my fans, the indie fans.
Yeah.
The John Rhys Davies autograph picture I have, I came home from work one day and I opened up my screen door, which is deliberately loud just from the movie. I opened the screen door and there was this envelope there, this bag, and I picked it up and I pulled this picture out, and there was a little, this beautiful note attached to it.
Do you still have the note?
I still have the note. I keep all notes that my guests give me, and I actually have a collage in the hallway upstairs of part of them. The other rest of them are over there ready for the new collage.
Right.
A lot of ephemera, stuff like that. I don't know what else to do with it. Like, I want to display it, but I don't.
Yeah, at the same time, yeah.
Right. So I have, we're doing these really beautiful collages. And so I read the note, and I've been closed since 2020 for tours, interior tours, because of COVID.
Right.
So this guy wrote me, it actually made me cry. And he's like, oh, I'm so sorry that I didn't get to see the inside, but I wanted to give you this because I appreciate the work that you do. You know, maintaining the house, keeping Indy's, you know,
legacy alive,
legacy alive, all those kinds of things. So he got this at the very first con that was held in the Middle East in Dubai, and he got that autographed by John Rhys Davies in Dubai, and he brought it by to give it to me to hang in the house. Like, it actually made me cry.
Yeah.
And then the autographed picture of Elsa.
Yeah.
And then that was given to me, sent to me by a follower on Instagram named Scott. And because I had posted a picture of the John Rhys Davies and told the story and everything, and he sent me a private message and asked me, would you be interested? And I was like, oh, that would be amazing.
Yeah.
So that's how I got that one. And when the scene opens, when before young Indy bursts into the house, these doors are closed.
Right.
And you can see the bookcases.
Right.
He's got baskets of
and he just throws
mailing tubes and books and papers. And I've got all that to make it look exactly like it.
And he just throws the door open. He's like, Dad.
He just flings the door open. As a matter of fact, here's all the tubes that I've been saving to wrap in plain brown paper.
Right.
And I also ordered off of Etsy. I ordered a bunch of really old stamps from that kind of same time period. And I'm going to put them on the tubes and put them in a basket. I have this. It was kind of weird how I... So this removed before flight flag.
Mm-hmm.
So a friend of mine gave it to me about 25 years ago.
Okay.
From an air show she went to. All
right.
And I was like, that's super cool. So I've kept it this whole time. Well, it kind of ties in a little bit where he has the fight with the guy under the plane because there are actually removed before flight.
Yeah, because the
flags hanging down.
Right, because they're on a pin that prevents the arms from exploding.
So I thought that that was pretty cool that I actually had that 25 years ago,
right.
And now it really belongs in the house.
Yeah.
What else? I have my Choose Wisely display.
Right.
A lot of these were mine when I moved out here. Some guests have sent me some.
And then this right here in the middle, that's the Holy Grail.
Yes, and I randomly move it around. It's not always in the same place.
That's funny.
And then I have friends have sent me stuff, you know.
But you don't have a replica of the chalice that Donovan drank out of, do you?
No, I don't have that.
Oh, you need to get one of those.
I know, yeah, right? Choose Wisely.
Yeah.
So, and then just, you know, I have some ink wells that look like the ones from the movie. So I've had those set aside for a while. I'm a huge book lover. So, of course, I have more upstairs. And then I have books I haven't even unpacked yet because I'm waiting to put my bookshelf in.
Right.
So it'll look really similar when I'm done because... You know, the books, the collectibles, you know, some of the stuff in the house was my grandparents, my great-grandparents.
Mm-hmm.
So it would have actually fit my great-grandparents' time era. So
when you, when eventually, you know, the house doesn't operate as a bed and breakfast, are you going to make it look 100% like it did in the movie?
I would like to.
Yeah.
But I don't... We'll have to see how the next few years goes as a bed and breakfast, see how much town grows, you know. I only have 3 rooms, and I am about 90 to 95% booked in the summer. I have waiting lists over the summer for people that want to come stay with me. So I would love to be able to put that wall back in and just completely set up this whole room like his study. The problem is obviously running as a bed and breakfast, it's a little hard.
Right.
Can't get to the kitchen. Nobody can sit here. I mean, I guess I could move the table over, but, you know. So I'm just working on a little bit of time. One of the projects I really, really, really want to complete is that bookcase around the double doors because I'm so excited to get that in. But I can't do that until my floor is done. So that won't be until next spring, probably.
So this is the original mailbox lid, right?
Yes. And when I went out, I don't know, about 4 weeks ago, the lid was missing from the mailbox, and I actually thought somebody stole it. but
it would not surprise me.
Yeah. But I've been was really lucky because it was just laying on the ground behind the mailbox, but it was upside down. So it kind of blended in with the rocks and the dirt and everything.
Right.
And I walked over there and I found it, and then I looked at it and realized that there is no way that I can reattach this.
Right.
So I went and found a piece of wood that's almost exactly the same color.
Yeah, and even if you could, it's so fragile that...
Yeah, I don't even want to put this out in the weather anymore.
Yeah.
The only thing I'm going to do is fill in these letters a little more.
Right.
It'll just continue to be displayed in the front window right underneath the Indiana Jones bed and breakfast sign.
Okay.
And because I want people to be able to see it.
Right.
You know, but it just can't be out in the weather anymore. You know, you see they've already repaired it once.
And that, I'm guessing that wasn't there in the movie, the repair job?
I don't think so.
Yeah, because in the movie it looks a little more intact than that.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
And this kind of just basically, it looks like it just cracked.
Yeah, it's just weathered. The weather is very harsh living down here.
Right.
And we're at almost 8,000 feet. You know, we're 10 feet from the sun, so everything gets beat up by the sun, the wind, the extreme cold in the wintertime. You know, summer weather is not too bad.
Right.
75, 80, not too bad at all. But the winters here are really harsh. And, you know, it's wood. It's not going to last forever.
Right.
So,
and it's better to preserve it now than, you know.
Right. And that's why it's not going back on.
Right.
And I'm pretty handy. So I can make a new one. And this one will still be here for people to look at.
Okay. All right. And, I mean, eventually you're probably going to have to replace the post, right?
You know, that post is still pretty sturdy, believe it or not.
Really?
I have to repaint it.
Right.
So what I'll do is I'll strip all the old paint off of it. I'll treat it, and then I'll paint it again.
Okay.
I do have to look at the movie again and make sure I get the right color on the post. But the mailbox itself will get sanded a little bit and then oiled a little bit to help
right.
protect that as well. But, you know, it's nature is just going to do its thing.
Right.
So,
okay.
Yep.
Well, thank you so much for your time.
You're welcome. Thank you for coming and visiting me.
Yeah, not a problem.
Yeah.
And if you guys want to check them out on Instagram, it's Indiana Jones Bed and Breakfast, all one word. Thanks for watching, guys.
Bye.
Bye.